Clémence, I think Dio sold their soul to the Watch my video first, would you? Okay. Bonjour, bonjour fragrance lovers, welcome back to my channel. In today's video is gonna be again the second one of series All You Need To Know About, and today is gonna be all about the history of Dior, and then I will get you my top 5 fragrances. So for that, if you want to go directly to that, you can definitely go to the description and you have everything you need. Alright, let's start. So Dior, obviously, is a French luxury house, and he was born in 1946. So according to Dior themselves, apparently it's 1947, but it's technically the year of the first fashion show that was inside. But technically, the brand was created in 1946, created by the designer Christian Dior. And now the company is led to by LVMH. But there was a lot of things happening before. What is Dior? They sell leather goods, makeup, fragrance, haute couture. It's really a lot of things, and it's a complete brand, I would say, because they touch everything. So the 16th of December 1946, the brand is launched in 30 Avenue Montaigne in Paris. But before talking about that, what happened before? Who is Christian Dior? Who is this man that just created a giant brand like this? How did he manage to get to there? Let me do a little resume of what was doing Christian before. So Christian Dior was born in 1905. So he was 41 when he created the brand Dior. So before that, he had a lot of experience in a lot of things. He started his life in a family of 5 children. He's the second one. It's a big family, and the dad is a really wealthy man because he's a famous manufacturer, fertilizer manufacturer, as I remember, and basically he's really wealthy. So Christian already have the money and a lot of things to do great thing. His parents wanted him to be a diplomat, but he didn't want that because he was very creative and he needed to express it. He made his studies, and in 1928 he decided to support a gallery, an art gallery, with the support of his dad. So his dad gave him money for him to support that project because he's fascinated about anything related to art. But unfortunately, we arrive in the 1930s, and it's where the Great Depression happened in France. So his dad unfortunately lose the control of his business and has to sell it. So basically they lose a part of their fortune, and unfortunately his mom and his brother passed away, and him just after that has to be sent to the army. First Great World War will happen. Just before the war and him going to the army, he started to work for Robert Piguet. So at this moment he was creating collection for him. And then after, when he left the army, he started to work for Lucien Lelong. And Lucien Lelong was working with a lot of designers, young designers, like Balmain, for example. So Balmain and Dior were working together. And now happened 1946. So what did happen? Basically, there's a man, he's called Marcel Broussac. Marcel Broussac is a successful entrepreneur, and he's known as the most richest man in France. And he has something to propose to Christian Dior. He wants him to design for Philippe Ecaston because he sees a great investment in that and a great success. So he asked him that, but Christian Dior refused the proposition and said he wanted to create something for him. He wants something unique and to start at the beginning. So he wants that fresh start, and Marcel Broussac is seeing the potential of this man and give him the opportunity to do it, so to create the brand he wanted. So basically, Christian Dior is not technically his company, it's Marcel Broussac that's having the company. And Marcel's got already a lot of investment everywhere, and basically the house Christian Dior would have a lot of investment inside all of the textile industry and everything like that. So it's not a small house, even at the beginning, it's meant to be a success. Marcel Boussac is a control freak, so basically he won't let anything go too creative. So Dior will be the creative mind and he will give him a good salary to do that, and then him will be the business around that. So Marcel, during those time, having hundreds of different business around Christian Dior. So that's why I tell you, I can't explain to that all of you. I read it and it was painful to read, you know, like this long description about economy, business. I was just like no. So 1947, 1 year after the creation of the company, is the first fashion collection in spring and summer. And this is basically what he does. It's not a real person that show off his dresses and his looks. It's 6 mannequins that are exposed just like a museum, just like an art gallery, and to show the creation. What Christian Dior proposes is a silhouette, a new silhouette, kind of a new silhouette. During the war, there was all about uniform. People were a bit sad and the clothes were sad and very simple. Unfortunately, it was the war, so this was like that. He wants to give back colors and glamorous. He wants to see more glamorous ladies, and this is what he gives. So he gives a silhouette with a corset like this, so you can see that the waist is really heightened and faces bust and the hip. So it's really the stereotype of a feminine look, which in his mind was missing during the war. And during the exhibition, during the fashion show, there's a famous quote by the editor-in-chief of Harper Bazaar. So it's really a magazine that is well known at the time and still now. And this lady, basically, whatever she was saying, everybody was taking it. It's just basically like Anna Wintour for Vogue. It's the same. And she see the collection, and the first thing that she said is, "It's such a new look." This sentence would stay, because the collection was not called like that. It was Carole and Huit. But after she said that, he decided everyone remember of the new look collection. This is really the event that will launch the popularity of Dior. Everyone wants to be glamorous again and beautiful, which is really nice. And at the moment, in 1947, he directly decided to create a Dior parfum, because for him, the fragrance is not an accessory, it's part of the show and needs to be treated as not just an accessory, as really a fashion piece that needs to be there. And for him, the look is not complete without the fragrance. And what he decides to be the emblem and the signature scent of Christian Dior is Miss Dior. So it was created by 2 famous names, which is Paul Vacher. If you don't remember Paul Vacher, he actually worked for Guerlain, and he also created Arpège from Lanvin, which is one of the most iconic scents of the 20s. There was also Jean Carles as well, that was quite well known in the perfumery at the moment. So 2 perfumers for 1 fragrance, and he created a fruity floral chypre. Chypre was really trendy at the time, as it was something a bit more, I would say, greener, and a lot of ingredients, very powerful, very opulent. It was basically something very mossy, and also a lot of aldehyde, so very fizzy with a lot of moss and flowers. And the fruity notes come from the bergamot, so it was really crazy opulent. And when you look at Miss Dior now, it's not at all mossy at all. Not at all. And he decided to call it Miss Dior for his sister Catherine Dior, that he wanted to show off in this fragrance. So we go now in the 50s, and in the 50s, Dior is so popular. They have a boutique in New York, they have a boutique in London, they have clients for Hollywood. Everyone wants to be dressed in Dior. They started to create a lot of fragrances at the moment, because we had Diorama in 1948. Diorama is a little plummy, I would say, fragrance. We had also in 1955 Eau Fraîche. We have Diorissimo in 1956, which is one of my favorite. It's a lot of lily, and it was called the fortune flower at the time, so it was really a lucky scent. And in 1951, he decided also to create the amphore, so basically Miss Dior will be turned into an iconic shape fragrance, which is the amphore that you can still purchase now, which whatever fragrance you want to put inside, and I think is divine. One day I will treat myself to this treat, definitely. So really, Dior at the moment is the antidote of the austerity of the war, and in the 50s is really like a success for him. Even Princess Margaret from the UK started to dress in Dior. This new look collection really influenced the future generation of designers. Until nowadays, like Thom Browne, or we have Miuccia Prada that was influenced by that, Vivienne Westwood, really this new look kind of style, and especially quoting the Dior's evening dresses that are very popular. But this is really the good part of the iceberg, I would say, because there was also a scandal. This collection didn't please everyone, especially feminist lady, because you know, like, after in the 20s we really like got rid of all this corset, we wanted freedom for ladies, and freedom of movement was the first thing that feminists was telling about, and it was really like a symbol, this corset, and this Christian Dior put back the corset, and there we go. And there was also like people like Coco Chanel that says, I'm quoting, "Only a man who never was intimate with a woman could design something that uncomfortable." And it makes sense, because Coco Chanel at the time was actually introducing materials like jersey to ladies to free their body and, you know, like to be free in their movement. And personally, my position on that is I'm a bit between the two. I do understand what feminist and Coco Chanel said, and at the same time, I really like that he wanted to take care of women and make them feel very glamorous, and the corset was not here to really encapsulate them. It was really like to make them feel really feminine and to emphasize this femininity. And I personally like the look of the two. I like to be ladylike, and I like also to have like something a bit more casual. But at the moment, ladies didn't have the right of voting, so I do understand it made a big scandal for sure. Next chapter is Dior without Christian Dior. Of course, like in 1957, unfortunately, Christian Dior passed away, so he's leaving the company, and it's really a massive disaster at the moment, because everyone want to drop the company, and it's really like a conversation between the directors and everything to actually leave the company, because there's not Christian Dior in. Marcel Broussac doesn't want this to happen and will give a new fresh hair to the house of Dior. And who is gonna save the situation basically is called Yves Saint Laurent. Dior was too important for the industry of France to be forgotten, so basically Marcel is looking for someone to replace him, and he's taking Yves Saint Laurent. And Yves Saint Laurent is a really meticulous and creative little boy, because he's 21 at this moment. And he designed a fragrance, and he started to design for the house of Christian Dior, and it would really be a fresh hair and a new modern time for them. He's done 6 collections for them, and then after he left, because Dior judges that he was too creative for them, and they wanted to keep a classic kind of touch, which kind of makes sense, but then after we all know the story of Yves Saint Laurent. So there's people like, for example, Elizabeth Taylor that are addicted to the creation of Dior, and it's in this moment that we have the most iconic scents of Dior that are represented. 1963 Diorling, 1966 Eau Sauvage, that will be, I would say, one of the most iconic fragrance for men in the whole 20th century for me, because it's the essence of something that is going to be timeless. It's fresh, it's refreshing, it's clean, it smells not too barbershop, it's basically very elegant but still casual, and match a lot of style. So I think for me it was a very smart move. We have Eau Sauvage, and in 1968, so the company is taking by LVMH. So this is my point when people are saying, oh, you know, nowadays Dior, they sold their soul to the devil, they just too commercial. But they always were kind of in that vibe, because it's since 1968 that LVMH is taking care of Dior, kind of. And they always been inside a big group. So it's not a new thing. It's always been like this, and it always been kind of a target that success, basically their fragrance are there, you know, to please a lot of people, which is great because it's symbol of generation. And even, you know, fragrance that I don't really like a lot now, probably will stay forever, like Eau Sauvage will do, because they are timeless and they are easy to wear, and it's a symbol of a generation, so it's not a bad thing. Talking more about the fragrance now, we have really a quality of ingredients. So even though some people were thinking, okay, this is starting to be a bit mainstream, you have with Dior a really incredible quality of ingredients, as some of the ingredients are, for example, in grass, which is the cradle of perfumery. They grow their May rose and the jasmine from grass in there, so it's not on all the fragrance, but having those quality of ingredient cost a lot of money, which probably reflecting the price of a fragrance as well. 300,000 flowers is 1 kilo of rose absolute, and 600 and 700 kilos of jasmine from grass is only 1 kilo of absolute. So can you imagine the price it costs to do that? It's incredible. So apart from that, in 1976 we have a lot of fragrance that we know: Dior, Diorella, Dior Essence, Jules for men. We have in 1994 Dolce Vita, we have June in 1991, and we have a lot of adverts during that time that will mark, I would say, generation. My personal favorite is the one with Alain Delon and Eau Sauvage, my god. And in 1999 we have the very glamorous J'adore that will be there, the essence of Dior. It's really something that for me really look like them, an essence of glamorous, shaped like a body of a lady. It's really a reminder of the new look again, which I think is really pretty. And in 1991 we have Hypnotic Poison for the sensuality, the iconic vibe. All of this changed for coming to 2006, and who is coming at this time is the in-house perfumer, the head perfumer of the house is François de Machy. So François will be the creator of lots of fragrance. Can you imagine, he's just there since 2006 and he's been created hundreds of fragrance. Like when you see about it, like it's just like being such a good move, I think, Dior, to get this man in there. Of course, before there was a lot of collaboration with a really well-known perfumer like Olivier Poche for Dior Homme, Francis Kurkdjian for Eau Noir, for example. So a lot of name. And François de Machy is there to give a modern boost. There's also a little move that they started to modernize the iconic scent, like Diorama, Dior Essence, Diorella, in nice bottle and nicely remastered. Personally, I can still feel the DNA of the classic, and they're really amazing fragrance till now. So I'm really happy to see them in this collection, still available, so it's beautiful. At that time, there's a lot of fragrance that we know. Dior Homme, the reformulation of it in 2011, that personally was really a good move. The first fragrance that was launched from Dior Homme was 2005, and it was great. But I think the 2011 was more around that iris and cacao scent that I think was beautiful. Anyway, I've done a video on that, so if you want to see it, it's just there. We have, of course, Eau Sauvage, but the Parfum Interpretation and things like that, which I think are beautiful. The Miss Dior editions, there's a lot of Miss Dior that is a bit confusing, to be honest. The Escale à Portofino, Pondicherry, that are fragrances that I really like. And of course, we have les exclusives of the house, which is Fève Délicieuse, Eau Disparant, lots of things like that that has been created that are absolutely stunning. And like such big fragrances that are not really like must-have fragrance, which is beautiful. The only thing that I'm gonna say is that it's quite annoying the way they actually reinterpret too many time fragrances. Like for example, I got out a bit of Dior when they started to remaster Miss Dior too much. To have Miss Dior when it was the edition of 2005 or something like that. And I really enjoyed it. I think it was beautiful. It was another interpretation of the classic, but more modernized, and it was beautiful. And then they started to do Miss Dior Chérie. That was really nice as well. And then they discontinued the two. And then we had another edition of Miss Dior and another one. And the new one is very much more sweeter, really trendy. And I thought it was really sad because that was just for me like killing a bit the brand image, and I this is the only move that I didn't really understand. And obviously the move of Dior Homme is just I can't still understand. And but again, this is not really surprising. Seeing the story of Dior, it's something that really they always wanted to modernize and modernize the brand. So it's not something that is not relevant. It's something not new. They've done that before, and it shouldn't be very surprising, and we should live with it, definitely. So what can we do? Even fragrance that I don't like really much, like Sauvage, sorry, I don't really like, I enjoy Sauvage. It's a very easy to wear fragrance, but it's working. Christian Dior wanted to do the same. He wanted to do a scent that is universal, to be the scent of an era, and I think it's totally working, and it's totally fine. And that's why sometimes I'm a bit upset about some move, and I try to remove this thing and think about the history, because it's actually normal. It's normal. And when I think of how this kind of brands at the time in France was actually a boost for the industry and the economy of France and things like that, we needed them and we still need them. And I think it's beautiful because it's part of our history a lot. It's not just fragrance or fashion, it's actually part of the history, and I think it's beautiful. So that's why, even though sometimes you can be a bit disappointing with your brand, I will never say, oh, this is blah 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 blah. We always need to be respectful. This video is going to be absolutely so long. I'm so sorry, but there's so much thing to say. When I started to do the research, I was like, oh my god, it's going to last forever. Anyway, let's go to my top 5 Dior fragrance. Right, so let's go to my top 5 fragrances from Dior. I had to stand up because after all this storytelling, I'm just a little bit, you know, need a bit of exercise. I didn't know how really to classify in 5 fragrances. It's really difficult. There's a lot I wanted to talk about, I couldn't. My honorable mention goes to Diorissimo for the Lily of the Valley scent that I absolutely love. Escala Portofino that I really enjoy for summer. Oud Ispahan that I really like. And of course, Fève Délicieuse that I really enjoy. So lots of things like this. So I had to include Fahrenheit for sure. For me, it's one of the best fragrances of Dior, just because I think it's a bit the alien of the range. It's so leathery and so intense, and it's got that very petrol-like scent. For me, it's the leather jacket of a brand that is very classic, and I think it's amazing to have such a very unique scent like that. For me, it would still one of the fragrances that has the most biggest character. If you want a fragrance that's going to give you character, definitely this one is going to be amazing. And I'm talking about the Eau de Toilette, not the Parfum. If you want to see my comparison between the Eau de Toilette and the Eau de Parfum, I will link it down below. And you will see everything about what I think of the two. Right, I think it's just like the bad boy of the fragrance of Dior. Number 4 was really difficult to choose, but I started to choose Ambre Nuit because for me it's like a very nice oriental fragrance for ladies and men, and I really enjoy it. It's got really that slight sweetness, slight oriental vibe. It's not a complicated scent as well, which I appreciate. And this one is just a normal one. I would say you can match it in really a lot of occasions. I think for me it's very sensual, slightly sexy. On a man, it's a bit more gourmand as well, which I really enjoy. So it's a fragrance that for me is kind of like a must have or must smell of the category. My number 3 is New Look, and this is part of the private collection as well. And this is a fragrance that is definitely more feminine, and I love New Look because of the history, obviously, that I told you just before. I think it really represents the scent of the 20s or the 40s. It's got really a powdery effect. It's very delicate, a light floral, but with a bit like a warmness intensity, but it's really a case of a powder. So when you think you're talking powder or you're just applying your loose powder or something on your face, it really smells like that. It smells blush to me, and I really enjoy that vibe, and you really have the perfumery of the old days, which is something that is quite light and skin scent, but have a lot of personality. And this is what I enjoy in this fragrance. It's got nothing really trendy, nothing that smells like fragrance of another days that are quite like it has to be long lasting, beast mode and blah blah blah. This is not like that, and this is what I enjoy personally. Number two is Eau Sauvage, just because I told you before, for me it's one of the most iconic gentleman scent of the 20th century, and it's still not dated. I'm talking about all the version of the Ordure Sauvage. I love the parfum and I love the classic as well. Of course there's more, but those two for me are the best. And really they have this tone that is quite citrusy and fresh that you can rock during summer, and you can also have this very spicy intense city for daytime in winter. It just smells very clean, very gentleman, but in a casual chic way. It's really all in a spontaneous elegance, and for me I really enjoy that. I think it's beautiful for that. And I don't know, like I feel a man should always have an Eau Sauvage in their fragrance collection. For me it's one of the most iconic. It's just like owning, like for me, a Guerlain Vetiver or something like that. Like the scent that needs to be in your collection. And for me Eau Sauvage is part of. And my first one, and this I'm hearing you already, stop I'm gonna hide somewhere. I know I shouldn't talk about it, but I'm gonna say it. It's Dior Homme 2011. Voilà. Bye. Me talking about patch? Seriously. yes, sometimes I do. Unfortunately, I personally really enjoy the 25, that was really pretty. The 2011 keeps the same DNA, which I really enjoy, except for me it's got that more chocolatey vibe that I think is really nice. And of course Dior Homme Intense, also I classify them in the two, okay, can I please? Dior Homme Intense is definitely my favorite. I absolutely love it because it gives like a bit more sensual tone, and Dior Homme being a bit more casual chic, Dior Homme Intense is even more sensual. It's so versatile, and it also is really reconforting. I never smell a fragrance that wanted me to cuddle someone so much. It's really, really pretty, comforting, romantic, sensual. It's basically giving anything, and the fact that it really revolutionized a bit perfumery with this note of iris that is so prominent is absolutely beautiful, and that for me categorizes this fragrance in the niche of the designer for me. If you want to see what you're thinking about the Dior Homme, it's there, but to give you like a little hint on that, I re-smelled it a few times now. I tried, and I stick to my places. I said in my review it's an okay fragrance, it's alright. I honestly don't want to lie to you, but I don't like it. I don't even know if it's a good fragrance now. Yeah, so no. But the Dior Homme is still available, the 2011, as far as I know, is still available in the website, but I don't know for how long. So that's the question, and the fact that Dior is a bit confusing with it, everyone's got different information. Oh, it's gonna stay, or it's gonna be there, or it's not gonna be there. I personally had different information from some consultant in Dior, so I don't know what to think, but for me the first one will be Dior Homme Intense and Dior Homme 2011. That's it for me. So tell me what's your top 5 fragrances from Dior. Please be kind in the comment. Like I don't know, like okay, you can be upset like me sometimes, you know, about that, but there's no need to express it too much. You can express it in a polite way. That's it. It's YouTube, you're hidden behind your computer, but you need to still to be respectful. That's it. But yeah, apart from that, I hope you enjoyed the video. I really enjoyed doing the research for you and to tell you this little story, so I really hope you're gonna like it as well. And I love those videos. I think it's so interesting. Well, at least for me. So that's it. So I will see you very soon, and I hope you're having a good day. And bye now.